This is a continuation for my lecture number 8. I want to summarize the material presented on the system design. Let's assume that we're working on a single input, single output control system. The controlled plant has traditional state variable description with a state vector. This is derivative of the state vector. This is the fundamental matrix, the state vector, matrix B. This is a scalar, the control effort. This is a scalar, the output of the control plant. And this is matrix C and the state vector. I want you to realize that in a realistic problem, state variables are real physical variables, and because of this, we cannot expect that matrix A, matrix B, and matrix C would have some convenient definitions. It is just an arbitrary system. The design specifications include the settling time that shall not be exceeded, percent overshoot that shall not be exceeded, and the steady state error for step disturbance that could be a constant but cannot exceed some top value. Or design specifications may be defined through the bandwidth of the closed loop system and the disturbance rejection in decibels. The step one of our design implies that we have to check on the controllability and the observability of the controlled plant. You know, I guess it's a rather academic statement. However, if you're dealing with a 50th order system, there is a good probability of improperly defined state vector of the system, of artificially inflated order of the system, and as a result you may start working on something that is uncontrollable or unobservable. The next is my step two, and I would recommend that you will convert this arbitrary state variable description into the canonical controllable form, and you will start doing this from defining this matrix P, the conversion filter, and you remember the procedure for establishing this matrix P. It's a square matrix, n by n. And this is how we will obtain matrix A of the CCF, matrix B of the CCF, and matrix C of the canonical controllable form. The next what you have to do is perform step number three. Step number three, you can perform by inspection. You will get the transfer matrix of the control plant only because you have A CCF, B CCF, and C CCF. I don't think you have to perform any matrix multiplication. You will get this result directly by inspection, as I said. Our next step is step four. I would check the existence of right-hand side zeros of the transfer function. How you do it? You take the polynomial numerator, equate it to zero, solve the resultant polynomial equation, and take a look at the real parts of the system zeros. If at least one zero is located in the right-hand side of the complex plane, our design technique will fail. Drastically fail, or fail to some degree, and therefore I would recommend terminate the design task if you will detect any right-hand side zeros of the controlled plant. How to handle situation with right-hand side zeros? Very soon I will show you the Diophantine technique that enables us to design a system in spite of having right-hand side zeros of the control plan. Our step number five calls for the definition of two complex conjugate dominant poles or eigenvalues of the closed-loop system. You may prefer to have one real dominant pole in the situation when your design is specified through the system bandwidth or if overshoot should be low. One way or another, these two complex conjugate dominant poles will be minus alpha plus minus j beta. Alpha will be defined on the basis of the settling time. And if you would take a look at the required overshoot, you will see the damping ratio that corresponds to this overshoot, and you will define matrix, you will define imaginary part beta. If you would be using bandwidth to define system dynamics, and the bandwidth is omega radians per second, then I would define alpha as 0.8 times omega and beta as 0.6 times omega. Where these numbers are coming from, I guess they're coming from this properties of the second order system. You're basically assuming that the dominant second order term, the damping ratio is 0.8, and in this case, overshoot is close to zero, and you will be able to determine the real part and imaginary part of two complex conjugate poles. Step number six is important in the sense that you may be forced to return to this step. This step calls for establishing of non-dominant eigenvalues or non-dominant poles, pole number 3, pole number 4, pole number 5, and so on, up to pole number n. And at this point, you have freedom of choice. Just make sure that these poles are non-dominant. Step number 7 requires you to establish the desired characteristic polynomial of the closed-loop system. This is how you define this polynomial, and this is this polynomial. And I would say that this type of multiplication could be very tedious. However, use computer tools and you will get result very efficiently and basically immediately. Step number 8, you have to define the desired closed-loop transfer function of the system that you want to build. And the definition of this transfer function is as follows. It has the desired characteristic polynomial, but also if S is 0, the transfer function of 0 must be equal to 1, and therefore constant gain is equal to the 0 order term, and obviously in this transfer function, this I transfer function, there is no zeros. Otherwise, you will be having problems with uncontrollable overshoot. The next what you have to do, you have to obtain the fundamental matrix of the canonical controllable form of the desired closed-loop system. I'm not asking for matrix B. I'm not asking for matrix C. Matrix A, fundamental matrix of the closed-loop system, is to be defined. How you define it? I guess you can do it by inspection. Step number 10, you are ready to compute matrix F of the state variable controller. I want to show you the matrix part of this task. I want to emphasize that you can do this type of operation in the most efficient and successful fashion. First of all, I want you to realize that if you would have matrix A, canonical controllable form of the plant, minus matrix B of the canonical controllable form of the plant, multiplied by matrix F of the controller intended for canonical controllable form, this is supposed to be equal to matrix desired that was earlier established. And now it is time to recall that matrix B of the canonical controllable form is a column with all zeros and one as the last element. So this equation in actuality is this equation. What can be done at this point? At this point, I will define matrix B of the CCF times matrix F of the canonical controllable form. It will be equal to matrix A of the CCF of the plant minus the desired matrix A of the closed loop system that also has a canonical controllable form configuration. You know, we cannot perform division in matrix environment. However, what I can do with this expression, I can multiply left-hand side and right-hand side by transposed matrix B, and this is what I did right here. So I have matrix B of CCF transposed times matrix B of CCF times matrix F of the canonical controllable form. It is equal to matrix B of the CCF transposed and, of course, multiplied by the difference between two matrices. But now you can easily figure out that this product is equal to 1, and therefore matrix F of the canonical controllable form of the controller is exactly this product. Well, you can also say that this is the difference between two fundamental matrices, and this multiplication is nothing but cutting out the last row from this square matrix equal to a difference between ACCF and A design. But then I want you to recall that the state variable feedback controller, if I would write it down for the CCF version, will have filter W in the reference input minus state variable feedback. And state variable feedback is matrix F of the CCF times matrix times vector X, vector of state variables. But vector of state variables that correspond to canonical controllable form. Now, at some point, I showed you that the arbitrary form of the state variable description of the control plant is to be converted into the CCF. The conversion filter is square matrix P. And if we would perform this conversion, then X of the CCF supposed to be equal to matrix P, the conversion filter, times vector X of the original state variables of the arbitrary form. And then, of course, I can claim that the controller now has this equation where matrix F is the matrix F of the controller intended for the arbitrary form. It's equal to matrix F of the controller CCF times the conversion filter P. And this is why you have to keep this in mind. But when it comes to solving your problem, this is one single expression that would define for you matrix F for your system. And this matrix F will be working beautifully with the original physical state variables of the control plane. Now it is time to obtain the filter of the reference input. This is how we define this filter. The numerator has constant gain Q0. What is Q0? Q0 is the zero order term from the desired characteristic polynomial of the closed loop system. And this polynomial in the denominator is the numerator of the transfer function of the controlled plant. This is what you do. Step 12. Step 12 requires us to check the steady state error for a unit step disturbance. And this is the formula that gives you the error. And this formula could be easily obtained from the response of the system to unit step disturbance. All right? Now, this response should be, you have to multiply this response by S and take limit when S approaches zero. So this is what you're supposed to get. Now, when you will get this value, make sure that it does not exceed the allowable value of the error. And if it does, you have to go to step number 6, define non-dominant eigenvalues, and when you will do this, well, I guess you have to keep some early material from our class in mind. Now, what we have to do if we're working with the bandwidth and disturbance rejection specifications. In this case, I don't think this error would be unnecessary, but your emphasis will be on step 13. And for this step requires for obtaining two transfer functions, one for reference and one for disturbance channels, but it should be done for the closed loop system. So this is one transfer function, and you know how to build it. This is another one, and you also know how to define it. And then you have to obtain the appropriate frequency responses for the reference channel and for the disturbance channel. The next step is to obtain body magnitude plots for the reference channel and for the disturbance channel. When you will be looking at, and of course you have to plot these characteristics, and this plot should be attached to your report on the project, system design project. But when you will look at the border plot of the reference channel, you would easily define the system bandwidth. And since system bandwidth is established through the dominant poles, I don't think there will be any problem with the system bandwidth. If you chose dominant poles properly, system bandwidth will be what it's supposed to be. Now, you cannot say this about the disturbance rejection, because when you will get the disturbance rejection plot, you have to look for the maximum point of the disturbance of the magnitude plot for the disturbance channel. It may be or may not be what it's supposed to be. Now, what if you're not having sufficient disturbance rejection? What to do? If disturbance rejection of the system is insufficient, you have to go back to step six. You have to choose new non-dominant poles, and you have to go through the entire chain of operations again. Now, step 15 requires you to support your design by a simulation study. When you will work in the industry, you will learn this and realize that there is no excuse for not providing necessary simulation study for your project. What are you supposed to show? You have to show a system step response, to a unit step reference. You have to show system response to unit step disturbance. You have to show system bandwidth. You have to show the magnitude of the control effort as system response to unit step disturbance and system response to unit step reference. You may also add system response to a ramp reference and system response to ramp disturbance. The system response to ramp disturbance may not be what you expected to have. It may not be specified, but if it is specified and you will get a steady state value for error caused by disturbance equal to infinity, obviously you have to go back to the drawing board and you have to introduce integrator in the system. And as a matter of fact, if you would introduce integrator in the system, you go back to step two, because you will get new state variable description of the control plant. You will have to obtain CCF of it and go on with your project. You know, at this point, I want to show you a case study, because I want you to see how a good engineer would present his or her project to superiors. This is the case study that I prepared. I want you to realize that the case study should use data produced by a software tool. And the best if this data comes directly from the software tool. You probably will be using MATLAB, and this means that no hand calculations are allowed in a realistic situation, because MATLAB will be responsible for the accuracy and for the transparency of what you have done, and having a MATLAB file would allow your superiors and, God forbid, FBI to check what you have done in your project. So yes, the best way is to write a MATLAB code that would perform all your computations. One way or another, I want you to consider with me the following design problem. There is a controlled plant. It is described by real equations of physics. It's a third-order plant, and it has a matrix, a fundamental matrix, which is 3x3, and it's obviously arbitrary matrix. It's matrix B, 3x1, and matrix C, 1x3. It is not a CCF. It's an arbitrary form. The next, what I am doing, I am building filter, special matrix filter for conversion, the arbitrary form to CCF. Now I want you to avoid confusion. I decided to call this filter W, not P. The name for the matrix filter is irrelevant, okay? The important is how you define this matrix. So my matrix filter, intended for conversion of the arbitrary form into CCF, is called W. First, I have to establish this row matrix Q. I follow the material presented in my class. First of all, I have matrix S. The first column of this matrix S is B. This matrix B of the control plane. The second column of matrix S is A times B. Matrix A1 is the fundamental matrix of the control plane. And the third column is matrix A squared times B. And then matrix S is raised in the power of minus 1. And then I pre-multiply it by 0.001, which effectively means that I am cutting out the last row from this square matrix. And now I am ready to establish this matrix filter. It's also a square matrix. Its upper row is matrix Q, defined right here. Its second row is matrix Q times the fundamental matrix of the control plant A1. Its third row is matrix Q times the fundamental matrix of the control plant A1 in the power of 2. And this is a square matrix. And I want you to keep in mind that we will need this matrix in the future. First of all, I establish ACCF, fundamental matrix of the control plane, in the canonical controllable form. It is W times A1 times W in the power of minus 1. Conversion to CCF. Matrix B of the CCF, traditional conversion to CCF. A matrix C of the CCF, done according to the rules. And now I want to print out these three matrices. This is matrix A, CCF. Obviously, this is 0, this is 1, this is 0, this is 0, this is 0, this is 1, this last row is not zeros. I guess you know how to build this last row by inspection from the, to do it, you have to have the transfer function of the control plane. All right, this is matrix B of the CCF. It has 0, 0, and 1. And matrix C of the CCF, technically, you could build it by inspection, but to do so, you have to have the transfer function of the control plane. And you didn't, so you have to get it by this conversion process. Keep in mind, we will need this matrix W, the conversion filter, because this conversion filter we will use to find the relationship between the state vector of the original physical variables and the state vector of the CCF, but we would need this relationship a little bit later. The next, what I am doing, I am establishing the closed loop dynamics using dominant and non-dominant poles, and keeping in mind that if the desired closed loop transfer function of our system S is replaced by zero, it should be equal to one. So listen, obviously, look at this term. I have a non-dominant pole equal to minus 20. Look at this second order term. It's a second order dominant term. I would say it corresponds to two complex conjugate dominant poles, minus 4 plus minus j. All right? Now, why do I have 20 by 17? Because in this condition, if s is equal to 0, I will have 340 in the numerator. In the denominator, I will have 17 times 20, which is also 340. What do we do next? The next, I want to get the canonical controllable form for this desired closed loop system transfer function. I decided to use my software. What I'm doing is this. Do canonical controllable form for this transfer function. The result, you can also call it G closed loop. And then I will split this canonical controllable form into matrix. Look, G closed loop, the canonical controllable form, I split into matrix A, matrix B, matrix C, and matrix D, that will be zero. I did it this way. Is it the most intelligent way of doing it? I wouldn't say so. If I would be doing this again, I would realize a couple of things. First of all, I don't need matrix B of the CCF, and I don't need matrix C of the CCF. And I actually even for sure don't need matrix D. What I need is only matrix A, the fundamental matrix of the desired closed loop system. And I can get it by inspection from this transfer function. So if I would be doing this exercise again, I would just get polynomial denominator. I have the numerator, and from the polynomial denominator, by inspection, I will get matrix A closed loop. Now it is time for me to get the matrix F of the controller, but matrix F intended for the canonical controllable form. So you are familiar with this expression. This is matrix A, canonical controllable form for the plant. This is matrix A, canonical controllable form for the desired closed loop system. This is, I guess, it's inverted matrix B. Now, excuse me, it is transposed matrix B, if you want to view it this way. Or this is the way to cut out, extract last row of this difference between two square matrices. One way or another, I have this matrix F intended for canonical controllable form. Listen, I didn't have to perform this step, but look what I did. I took matrix C of the canonical controllable form of the plant. I multiply it by unit matrix times S minus matrix A of the canonical controllable form plus matrix B of the canonical controllable form times matrix F for for the canonical controllable form. And this expression in brackets, I raise in the power of minus 1, and I multiply it by matrix B of the canonical controllable form. Why I'm doing this? I want to make sure that the matrix F works properly. So when I got this result, I got something horrendous, and it looks horrendous because of the noise, computational noise. And therefore, I got it second time, I call it matrix G, and I have a procedure in my software. In MATLAB, you also have this procedure, just find it. Find this procedure. Procedure that enables us to perform pole zero cancellation in order to eliminate those terms that are caused by numerical noise. And when I performed this near operation, one cancellation took place, and guess what I had? I got transfer function G. What is special about this transfer function? The special is this. It has the denominator of the desired closed loop transfer function, and it has the numerator of the control plane transfer function. Why? Because I never had chance to cancel zeros of the control plane yet. So since the denominator of this transfer function is acceptable, is exactly what it's supposed to be, I have evidence that matrix F, CCF, was properly defined. What I have to do now is to introduce a special filter. The purpose of this filter is to eliminate zeros of the control plant, and also the second purpose of this filter is to make sure that if I would replace S by zero in the transfer function for the reference input of the closed loop system, the value will be 1. So this filter is defined right here, and transfer function for reference will be equal to the original closed loop transfer function times the filter. And I guess after cancellation, I will get exactly the desired closed loop system transfer function. I would love to claim that the problem of design was successfully solved, but this is not true. So far, I was able to come up with a state variable controller that calls for the state vector of the canonical controllable form, and all state variables of the CCF are fictitious variables. I have to make sure that my controller will be working with real physical variables. So, if I would define controller equal to controller of the CCF times the conversion filter matrix W early established, this is what I will get. And now, what I will do, I will determine the transfer closed loop transfer function of the system, which will be transfer function for the reference channel defined as matrix C, the true matrix C of the plant, the arbitrary form, unit matrix times S, matrix A, fundamental matrix of the arbitrary form, times plus matrix B of the arbitrary form, times matrix F that I have for real physical variables. This term is in the power of minus 1 times matrix B. I have this result, but then I multiplied it by the filter that earlier was established filter H. And again, I am getting a result that is effectively horrific. But then I perform the simplification procedure, and three cancellations are performed by my software tool, and I have now the desired closed loop transfer function for the reference channel. Hallelujah. So this is an example of how you should present materials to your superiors. And I guess you can don't be greedy as far as adding this textual stuff. Now what I have to do is to perform a simulation study. And this is my control plant established by the equations of physics. Obviously, these are elements of matrix C, state variables x1, x2, and x3. They are real physical variables. This is how the output is defined. This is how I define a state variable x1, because what you see here is first state equation. This is the second state equation. This is the state equation number 3. They are fully consistent with the original matrix vector description of the control plant. I'm not using any transfer functions here. Now, what I have here, this stuff I represented by a compound block, and I call it plant. This plant has output y, and it has first state variable x1, second state variable, and the third state variable. And each of the state variables is multiplied by the coefficients of matrix F, the matrix intended for real physical variables. This is the inverse of sign, changing sign to minus. This is the step reference. And this is the filter that was earlier defined. What do we have now? We should see the step response. And this is the step response of the reference channel. It converges to 1 because the magnitude of the reference was 1. The settling time, as was considered when I chose dominant eigenvalues, is 1 second. Everything is perfect. The overshoot is very, very low, actually 0 overshoot. So I guess everything is fine. Now it is time to investigate system response to step disturbance. Look, reference is applied through the filter, but disturbance applied directly to the input of the control plant. And look what I have. Disturbance is equal to 0.3 over unit. I can get the same result analytically. This is how you get disturbance by an analytical expression. And this is 0.03 over unit. The next, what I did, I investigated system response to ramp reference. Reference is 0.25 T. And look what I do. Reference is applied directly to the plotter, and the same reference is applied to the reference input. And I have these two parallel ramp type lines. This tells me that the steady state error for ramp reference is 0.13 over unit. And of course I can get this result analytically. Except it looks a little bit hairy, but it's 0.13 over unit. You know what is interesting? You can get this result without going through all this mathematics. You know, this is the ramp, the slope of the ramp reference, slope of the ramp reference. This is the zero order term from the desired characteristic polynomial, and this is a coefficient of s in the power of 1 from the desired characteristic polynomial of the system. The next, what I did, I checked system response to ramp disturbance. Disturbance is applied directly to the input of the control plant. The slope was 0.25 for this ramp disturbance. And you see that system response approaches its ramp. It approaches infinity. As time approaches infinity, the magnitude should approach infinity. Now, you want to check it by an analytical, through an analytical expression? Yeah, it is infinity, all right. How to handle the situation? And you already know from listening to my class, to my lectures, that you have to introduce integrator in the input of the controlled plant. This is the original controlled plant. You know, what I will do is this. I will introduce additional state variable x4. Okay, I will pick up the output y. And x4 will be defined as the integral of the output y. Now, what will happen now with matrix A, matrix B, and matrix C? Matrix A, the fundamental, first of all, the system now will be a 4x4, will be a fourth order system. Fundamental matrix will be a 4x4 matrix. It will have an additional column filled with zeros. And it will be last column. Matrix B of this arbitrary system will have additional element, which is zero. Matrix C will have 0, 0, 0, and the last element is 1. Now, what is special about row number 4? Row number 4 now, at least first three elements of row number 4, they are elements of matrix C of the original state variable description of the plant. Please keep this in mind. Now, am I successful in doing this mathematics? Let's check it. I will get the transfer function just to verify my results. I'm getting the transfer function of the system with the integrator in the input. Yeah, you see this integrator. What you have here is the original system transfer function and additional s in the denominator. Yeah, this is a fourth order system now. Can we design a state variable controller for the extended or augmented control plan? Sure, we can. Now, what we have to do is to obtain the CCF for the plant. You know what I'm doing here? I'm getting this CCF on the basis of this transfer function by inspection. By inspection. by inspection. So I have the CCF. I have the CCF. However, later I will be forced to build a new conversion filter, because I don't need conversion filter for establishing the CCF, but I will need conversion filter in order to switch from the matrix F for CCF to matrix F for real physical variables. But this will be done later on. Look what I did now. You recognize this transfer function. This is the desired closed-loop transfer function for the reference channel. It has dominant terms. If you would recall, they correspond to two complex conjugate dominant poles, minus 4 plus minus j. This is the first non-dominant pole and the second non-dominant pole. And this constant gain is chosen to make sure that if I would replace s by 0 in this expression, I will get value of 1. And of course, by inspection now, well, I did not do it by inspection. I did it by formally obtaining CCF for this expression, and then unpacking this expression and extracting matrix A closed loop. This is the matrix A closed loop established. Could I get it by inspection? Sure I can. If I would invest time in building polynomial for this denominator, of course I would be able to use coefficients of this polynomial to establish matrix A of the closed loop system. All right. The next, what I did, I have to establish the matrix F of the controller for the CCF. And there is nothing new about this expression. And this is the controller. But this controller is looking for variables of the canonical controllable form. You cannot implement a controller like this. Now, I am checking the controller, whether this choice of the controller was indeed successful, and what I have by getting matrix C times the... Look, this is the matrix definition of the matrix definition of the closed loop system without filter. And this is what I have. This expression has zeros of the control numerator of the control plant, and it has the denominator, desired denominator of the closed loop system. And of course I know that these zeros should be canceled, and the constant gain equal to 8500 should be installed. In this case, transfer function for the reference channel with S equal to 0 will be equal to 1. And this is the filter. This filter is supposed to cancel the zeros and install the constant gain of 8500. But now it is time to pay the price for not establishing the conversion filter earlier. I did not need this conversion filter to build the CCF for the control plan, but I need conversion filter because I want to have a realistic state variable controller that would work with the real physical variables. So look, I'm going through the routine. I built matrix Q first. This is matrix S, we call it earlier. It's raised in the power of minus 1. I am extracting last row from this matrix. I call this last row Q. And now I build this conversion filter. It's 4 by 4 filter now. First row is Q. Second is Q times A squared. And so on and so forth. This is the conversion filter. And now I have matrix F for the realistic state variable controller equal to the original matrix F for the CCF system times the conversion filter, and this is the matrix F that will be working with real physical variables. Would it work with the real physical variables? I guess it does, because first I got the closed loop transfer function. Look, I'm using now the initial arbitrary form. I have this result. This result calls for the filter. If I would introduce filter and later simplify the expression, I will get exactly what I was intending to get, the desired closed loop system transfer function for the reference channel, of course. Now I would like to compute steady state error for a ramp disturbance. And the steady state error for the ramp disturbance, I follow all the mathematics that was discussed in my class. And I want you to pay attention in the last expression. You know what it is? This is the slope of the ramp. This is the zero order term of the desired characteristic polynomial. This is the coefficient of s in the power of 1 in the desired characteristic polynomial. The result is 0.14. Can we simulate the control plane? Please don't tell me that my simulation is too similar to the simulation of the original control plan. Why it is similar? Well, some of the variable definitions are similar. Some of the state equations are similar. They are similar because, if you remember, the fundamental matrix A of the extended control plan had a column filled with zeros, and because of this, state variable x4 did not contribute into state variable x1, state variable x4 did not contribute into state variable x2, did not contribute into state variable x3, and as a matter of fact, this is the definition of state variable x4. It is right here. State variable x4 does not contribute to its own state equation. And this result is very straightforward. State variable x4 is equal to the output, because we're placing integrator in series with the control plant. And this is simulation of our system. I am applying first a ramp reference. It doesn't make sense to apply step reference. I know beforehand what will happen. The ramp reference. And the system responds to ramp reference. Yeah, I guess first you have result. System responds to a step reference. And you're not surprised about this result, because everything is perfect. This is the system response to a ramp disturbance. To a ramp disturbance. And the result of the simulation is well, I guess let's keep looking. Yeah, this schematic shows you system response to step reference. This is system response to ramp disturbance, and the result supposed to be, oh, it's right here, 3031. Point 3031. So it's a constant. Initially it was infinity. So it's an improvement. To ramp reference. To ramp reference. And I guess I did not measure this, the distance between these two horizontal lines. And I guess this is the end of my case study. So please note that when you will be doing this for your employer, and earlier, before you will be doing this type of exercises as a part of your take-home final exam, make sure that you will adopt this format of presenting results and present results as complete as you can. So this has been an addition to my lecture number 8.